Chapter 12. After a few years of living here and getting to know the inhabitants, I had an epiphany that was to change my entire outlook on the way that the village should be read. I once casually remarked to one of our neighbours, Mika, as we drove back from the shop together, that I supposed that every person in the village must have 100 stories in their repertoire. He replied,
"Nemaš to priča. To je priča jedna u selu I gotovo. Nemaš to priča."
There aren't 100 stories. There is just one story, and that is it. The whole village is just one story. I realized then that the way to interpret the village was not to read it as a collection of individual anecdotes, but as a continuous narrative thread woven from a great number of strands, as a conduit through which the history of the village is conveyed, and like a piece of rope that gathers its strength from all those strands bound together. I understood at that moment that the now and the then had become almost indistinguishable. And this supposition took on more gravity the more stories I heard. From our house, one need only step out the front door and the village will greet you. And that is, if Bara is outside sweeping the road. She lives directly opposite, and our stretch of road is surely the cleanest in the village. Much to her annoyance, a large walnut tree in our front garden sheds its leaves across the road in autumn, and which she tends to sweep in piles on our verge. For a person who does not venture anywhere outside the narrow confines of her domain, Bara is remarkably well informed about the goings on in the village. Rarely does she ever have visitors, particularly since our road leads only to where Mara lives, at the last house in the village, and the woods. So where she manages to find out so much about the village's activities remains one of the most intriguing village mysteries of all. Such mysteries as she is willing to impart, I get the benefit of when I go to retrieve the piles of walnut leaves shoved under our hedge. Unlike in certain English regions, this hedge betrays nothing of its age. It is just a few years old, and was replanted when we had to sacrifice the original hedge for the road. Largely of hornbeam, there are thin, straggly branches of willow growing out of one corner like dishevelled hair. And this was my attempt at growing a fedge, a living fence of woven withers. It looked good at the time, but couldn't stand up to the conditions that were required of it. As well as losing that stretch of hedge when the tarmac road was laid, we also lost a couple of plum trees that were grubbed up to enable the road-laying machine to negotiate the original rutted track, a track that now lies buried beneath the bitumen. With little traffic at our end of the village, it was not felt necessary to widen or straighten the road, so the new road continues to twist and turn as it had originally done, adhering to the same contours and just wide enough for a horse and cart, or tractor. After my morning update of local affairs from Bara, I start walking and follow the road as it snakes off towards the far end of our end of the village. Almost immediately I reach Barkayela's house, where my story of filming begins. Here, her second brother, Mate, was also born and lived there until he got married and took a piece of land opposite to build his own house in 1957, a house that we now occupy. His sister, Yella, remained, and unusually, when she married, her husband moved here to join her. A few steps further, and here on the left, tall yellow flowers mark a termination point of our land. A short vestige of hedge concludes. It has a gap, an entrance to a footpath turning off the road, and which separates our land from another neighbour. Bukovlje is still a village without running water, and this path is often used, since it leads to the natural spring where everyone from our end of the village comes to collect drinking water. Around the source, the surrounding fields fold in and direct one down to where a fissure in the rock leaks fresh water. One needs to be sure that any water required be gathered before it rains, as this tends to cloud the water, giving it an earthy taste. The collection of water was made all the more easier by its enclosure in 1956. Prior to this, people spent a great deal of time waiting for their vessels to fill from the trickle, until one chap, a certain Janko Fudorich, took the initiative to find a solution to this problem. As I was researching this story, I managed to find several people who still remember him distinctly and were willing to talk about him. Janko was a tall, handsome man, and it became quite clear that he always managed to leave a deep impression on anyone he encountered. He had once been a waiter in the cafe across the river, so was clearly a sociable chap. Darko Domšić was just a small boy, but he clearly remembered Janko, so we asked him.
A čuli smo da, da Janko je gradio ta zdenac.
Zdenac, je to Janko napravio one betoni?
Yeah.
We heard that Janko built the enclosure around the spring, is that correct? Yes, yes. He was in the local youth movement and he would often organize parties and dances. And from the money he raised, he bought cement and materials. Darko explains. It is written there too. Yes, we only saw that recently, his signature inscribed in a cement wall. Before, it was just a crack in the rock from where the water trickled out. And today it remains exactly as he built it. And Bara was next to give her account. Janko wanted to enclose the spring. Then it was just a hole, and you had to hold a bottle under it. But he said, how can we do that when there is no money around? I know, let's have a party. We can hold it at the old building at the Stojković household.
A to je bilo u školi tamo.
Wasn't that a school at one time, I ask.
Tamo prije bila škola.
Yes, it was, she replied. So he made an entrance, hired a band of musicians, made a stage for them, and we just paid the entrance fee. And that was for everyone in the village? Well, for anyone who wanted to go. And did you see his inscription written on the inside? Yes, I told her. After Bari, we went to visit a woman called Matze, who remembered attending Janko's parties. Girls did not sit at tables as they do now. Instead, they lined the wall on one side and the boys on the other. When the band started playing, they would come over and ask us to dance. That is how it was. That is how we socialized in those days. I'd heard so many accounts of Janko over the years that he almost took on a mythical status. His presence seemed to permeate the landscape around and the hearts of many ladies. He seemed at certain moments to be almost a fictitious character, until one day I had to lean into the trough collecting the spring water, and ducking my head underneath the lip, I saw the inscription in the concrete, just to the right on the wall. Fudorić Janko, 1956. This was quite an emotional discovery because Janko had finally become real. He had become grounded, and this was the first-hand evidence that he had existed at all outside the village stories. The trace of Janko's hand is small, but the impact he had on the village is significant. His hand still reaches into the present moment and touches the lives of everyone who visits the spring for drinking water. In conclusion, Bara adds, he said to me, now you have something to remember me by. Within months of building this enclosure, Janko left for Argentina, following the footsteps of both his mother and the father. A father with whom he had never actually met, since he had left the village soon after Janko was born. But en route to South America, Janko stopped off in Trieste, And while there, he sent a postcard photograph of himself back to his friends in the village. This was in 1957, and after which the house was locked and remained empty. Some years later, once he had settled in Buenos Aires, he sold the house to one of the members of the Domšić family, grandfather Marco, who was visiting him there. The house was then dismantled and lugged timber by timber up the hill to the part of the village above us, locally known as Tsari, where it was reassembled and a cow took up residence. During a conversation with Jana, who helped haul the house's aching timbers up the hill, she told me of an occasion when Janko returned to Bukovlje with his daughter Sylvia some time in the 1990s, and remembered how Janko, upon arriving, knelt down and kissed the threshold. Such was his joy to see his house again. Sylvia removed the house number to take home as a souvenir. It was Janko's last visit back to his birthplace.